Thank you. Can you all hear me okay? I usually talk pretty loud. We are ER people tend to be pretty loud. Talking about the flu, very, very, very pertinent subject today. We're about ready to hit the prime of the season next month. We're not there yet. Usually the apex of the season is in about January. About January is where it really starts hitting, but we still have multiple cases, but just not as heavy, and starting in about October. How many of you have received a flu vaccine this year?
I've tried.
You've tried?
The doctor keeps running out.
I'm sorry to hear that about you not getting it yet, but I'm glad to hear that he's running out because that means people are getting it. And I'll explain to you the importance of that and hopefully dispel any feeling. Vaccines, at times, you have a group of people who strongly believe that vaccines, but we're talking mostly immunization vaccines with children, and there's been a lot of people who have the fear that it may cause autism or may have some negative effects. I know there's a very famous video out of a lady who has just very spastic walking. You can see it on YouTube. It's been on 2020, and she swears it was after getting vaccinated, but we'll talk about that here in a bit. What is the flu? First line, obviously, very, very, very contagious viral illness. Underlined viral, which leads to the next point, no antibiotics are needed. Antibiotics work against bacteria. They have nothing to do with viruses whatsoever. It's very unpredictable. The severity varies widely from season to season. The variability and the severity has a lot to do with what strains, and we'll cover exactly what I mean by a strain, what strains are present, how many people get vaccinated, as well as how well that vaccine that year matches up with the strains of the virus for that year causing the infection. Viruses are crazy smart. I often say, and I've said it many times, and I've said it for years, the end of mankind is not going to be some nuclear war. I strongly believe it will be caused by a virus. These things mutate, change their forms, and continue to try to outrun us, but the Centers for Disease Control does a pretty good job at trying to predict ahead of time what strains are going to be causing the flu in the years to come. And they do that by just basically what the pattern has been in the last, about 50 years. How is it spread? Through respiratory droplets. We've all probably seen a slide like this, but it's not to be, I mean, you can just imagine yourself in a restaurant, somebody coughing who's across the table from you or whatnot. It's that cough, that sneeze, and even they say talking can propel respiratory droplets, and you inhale them and you can become sick. The droplets, unfortunately, are very resistant. The flu virus can live on surfaces, this table, for hours, not days, but for hours. So you can get it from direct contact, putting hand virus, then hand up to face, in your nose, in your mouth, in your nose, whatever, wherever your hand goes. Once you get it, people often ask me, how long am I contagious? When can I go back to work? When can I start kissing my baby again? And it's basically shown that, and it's really tough, you can be infective starting before you even have the symptoms, which just isn't doggone fair. One day before their symptoms, a patient's symptoms start, to about 1 week after getting sick. After about 1 week, your immune system has formed enough antibodies to suppress the virus so you really don't have to worry about being infective anymore. But that's a pretty good length of time, particularly when you don't even know that you're sick to begin with. Symptoms, tough. They mimic a lot of anything viral. A common cold. This is usually, flu is more severe as far as these symptoms with the common cold. However, the common cold can present with many of these as well. Don't have to have fever, but you will be a lot more likely to have fever with flu than you are with a common cold. And what I mean by fever is a temperature above 100, well, above and equal to 100.4 degrees. If you're 99 and even 100, you're okay. 100.4 degrees, not 104, 100.4 degrees, we'll recognize as fever. Chills, sore throat, headache, muscle aches. Muscle aches mostly lower back and your, what's called your quadricep muscles, your thigh muscles here. Those are mainly the big muscle groups affected because those are the muscle groups we use quite often. We use the lower back musculature for our posture and obviously our quads, the forceps are the four muscles there to walk with. So usually it's in the back and the legs. Cough, usually dry, can be productive. If it is productive, it doesn't mean anything. For years, doctors and hence patients believed that if I cough and I'm coughing up colored stuff, yellow, green, whatever the case may be, then that usually means it's a bacteria. There's no truth to that whatsoever. Zero truth to that. And that's documented throughout medicine. All you gotta do is culture it and see if the bacteria grow out of yellow or green sputum as opposed to clear sputum, and there's no relation to what the color of sputum. Now the cough should never be bloody. If you have a really bad sore throat and a horrendous cough and you cough up some sputum that just has a little streak of blood in it, don't freak out. That's okay. But I'm talking, blood to fill up, the bottom of a Dixie cup or something of that sort. It should never be that pronounced. Of course, when you have all this, you're going to feel weak and fatigued. Just generalized feeling like crud. You just absolutely feel horrible. Vomiting and diarrhea, it can affect the GI tract. It's much more common in children, however, and that has to do with the antibody response that is manufactured. And as I said before, the vomiting and diarrhea, just like the coughing up of blood, should really never be bloody. Strain. What is a strain? And I'm not going to spend too much on this. I just want you guys to understand because the general public, for all intents and purposes, has heard of H1N1, right? H1N1. Oh my God, H1N1. He's got H1N1. We don't. Okay. What the hell is H1N1? And here's where that comes from. This is a viral particle. And on the outside, the cell wall of a viral particle, you have proteins. This is the way our body, our immune system, which doesn't get nearly the recognition it deserves. I mean, we all know about our hearts, we all know about our brains and how important those organs are. My goodness gracious, the immune system is just, every doggone day, we are up moving around, our immune systems are fighting something off. This virus, the immune system suppresses cancer genes called oncogenes. So we've got cancer genes that pop on up and our immune system suppresses the manifestation of cancer genes. So our immune system is, an argument could be made, it's the most important system in the body, but it comes right down to it, they're all important. The immune system recognizes these proteins on the cell wall of a viral particle. The H, so we say H1N1, the H stands for hemagglutinin. Okay, right here, it's just a protein on the wall of the viral particle. The N, so H and N, H1N1, we'll cover the 1 and 2s and 3s here in a second, the N protein, neuraminidase. right, this one. So they're just different proteins on the viral particle. That's the way our immune system recognizes. And that is way a strain is termed. So H1N1. Flu viruses are classified into subtypes. Now that's where we're talking about the numbers now, based on the antibody response to the two viral proteins, the hemagglutinin and the neuraminidase. There are 16 different types of H proteins and 9 different types of N proteins. However, only to human beings, for all intents and purposes, the vast majority, we as human beings only have to deal with the H1, 2, and 3, and the N1 and 2. So you can have a combination of anyone. So a flu strain that year, you hear it's H1N1, that's where it's coming from. H1, that particular protein, and N1, that particular protein. You can get any combination you want. H2N1, H2N2, H3N1, H3N2. So you can, there aren't a whole bunch of strains that are infective towards humans, but believe me, if that vaccine is not covering that strain and you're exposed, you will get the flu. Who's at risk? Very, very, very important. In the emergency room, and this is I guess the crux of the lecture, is to help people decide for themselves when in the heck to seek medical attention. Whether it's trying to get an appointment with their primary care physician or go to the emergency room. If you are, let me start out by saying, if you are over the age of 2 and under the age of 65 and you have no medical problems, okay? So under the age of 65, over the age of 2, you're probably gonna do just fine, okay? There's nothing to support that you're going to get sick and die, even though, just like having a hangover, you probably think you're gonna die. But and I understand that. But if you have no health problems, you will overcome this. You're a healthy individual, your body is strong enough, you will overcome, you will take care of yourself, so the treatment is supportive. If you have fever, that temperature above 100.4, Tylenol, ibuprofen, you can use the both for body aches as well. Sneezing, cough, and whatnot, you're probably fine using over-the-counter cough med if you think that you need it. But you're going to be miserable. You'll be miserable for as long as a week. You will overcome. Children under the age of 2, got to be a little bit careful. Children over the age of 6 months can get vaccinated. It's approved for children 6 months and over. So if you're 1-2 years old, you can get vaccinated. But children, I did training with an ER physician, and he is a great man, and he was very, very smart, one of the smartest men I've ever known. And he had all these, his last name was Adato. And he had these things we called Adatoisms, and all these sayings. And when I was training, I didn't understand a whole heck of a lot what he was saying, but then as I've gone further on in my career, now they make so much sense to me. He said, he used to have a saying, he says, you've got to pay attention to the very, very young, the very, very old, and the person you just can't stand. So I think it's kind of applicable here, right here, on age under 2. And it's tough because you get, in the emergency room, you get people coming in, they might not have the best hygiene in the world, they're inebriated, they're calling people names, and you just want to get them the hell out of there. You don't want to do anything for this person because they don't want you to do anything for them. But you've got to step back, set aside your biases, and then because they get sick as well. So children under the age of 2, got to be careful with kids. Adults 65 and older, the immune systems just aren't as strong as they used to be. I often say in the emergency room as well, after the age of 18, it's all downhill. Pregnant women, by definition, pregnant women are immunosuppressed. Again, there's a lot of camaraderie that goes on in the emergency room, so I tell the nurses all the time, basically, pregnancy is a parasitic infection. It is. You've got a being, a live being, living off of you, draining you for everything you don't work. And it goes all throughout life as well, I think, right? If you have kids. Yeah, I've got three of them, so I can say, but I didn't have to be pregnant with them. Pregnant women, immune systems are weakened. That's where you gotta be a little bit careful with them. And yes, pregnant women can get a flu vaccine. People with respiratory illnesses, asthma, COPD. Again, anything, if you are sick, if you have chronic illness, your body knows it. The immune system knows it. So your immune system is constantly trying to keep your body healthy. If your body is preoccupied by trying to take care of your asthma, or COPD is chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, it can be chronic asthma, chronic bronchitis, or emphysema, you are at risk. People with heart disease, people with coronary artery disease, people have stents, people have had heart attacks, people have congestive heart failure, the pump isn't working well. There are neurologic or neurodevelopmental conditions. What I mean is this is mental delay, cerebral palsy, Down syndrome, neurologic disorders, multiple sclerosis, what they call amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, Lou Gehrig, which is Lou Gehrig's disease. If your body is fighting those things off, you gotta be very careful with yourself. Sickle cell, yes, diabetes, kidney, people who are on dialysis, liver disorders, people who have cirrhosis. And last one, like I've kind of hit already said, anything that weakens the immune system, HIV, cancer itself, the therapy of cancer, chemo, radiation, even surgery, your immune systems are weakened. Steroids, not the steroids bodybuilders use, and not the anabolic steroids, corticosteroids that are often used in asthma, in COPD. They are used in neurologic disorders as well. They're very common. Most common one by pill is usually prednisone. The immunosuppressed due to medications from organ transplants. If you've had an organ transplant, kidney, lung, heart, whatever the case may be, you are on medication to keep your immune system weakened because your body is smart. Your body is smart. Your body damn well knows that that organ should not be there because it's not yours. You weren't born with it. So you have to suppress the immune system, keep your immune system from rejecting the organ. So, gotta be careful.
What about people that work with kids all day?
We're 100% getting there.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. You stole my thunder. It's all right. But the answer is yes, 100%, without a doubt. The biggest thing is so you don't bring their viruses home to your family. But yes, we will 100%, you're exactly right. What should be done if you are at risk? And what I mean at risk is the previous slide. Okay, what should be done if you're at risk and you get sick? Probably, and we see it again, in the emergency room, we see this all the time. We have people taking ambulance rides in because they're 32 years old, no medical problems, and they've been coughing for an hour. I've had somebody take an ambulance ride in because they have chapped lips.
What?
Very true. It's every day. Brian? Am I lying? You're a nurse. I mean, it's just, you just put your head down, it's like. But on the counterpoint, we have people walking in who are having active heart attacks, who are having active strokes. So they just didn't want to be a burden to anyone. So if you're sick and you have something to make your immune system weakened, tend to err on the side of seeking medical treatment sooner than later. Like I said, if you're over the age of 2 and less than 65 and you have no medical problems, you're okay to ride it out. I'm wincing a little bit when I say over the age of 2. I will never, I try not to criticize anyone, I will never find any fault with a parent bringing in their child because they're worried about their child's health. So if they bring in their child and they're 6 years old and they're worried about them having the flu, it's not like I'm saying, I'm going to say, oh, you did the wrong thing, you shouldn't have known your kids over sick, blah, blah, blah. No, I can't. You got to be careful with kids. But warning signs for adults. Labor breathing. I just can't get my breath. I can't even walk to the mailbox. My God, you know, just labored breathing. Chest pressure. Probably shouldn't be having any pressure in your chest. You know, cough. If you're an asthmatic, you know your body. Asthmatics can oftentimes feel pressure in their chest, but you know your body. If this is unusual for yourself, seek medical attention if you're in a high-risk group. Profound dizziness, and I put profound. If you're dizzy to the point where you can't walk, that's probably, if you're in a high-risk group, probably maybe call your doctor. Confusion. Flu shouldn't make you confused. Bloody diarrhea or vomitus. So if you've got blood in your stool and or in your vomit, seek medical attention. On the warning signs for children, fast breathing. Hard to say how fast, but if they're breathing more than one time a minute, I'm sorry, one time a second. Breathing more than one time a minute. That would be slow breathing. That would be so. But if they're breathing more than one time a second, yeah, say, forget it, put them in a room, shut the door. They're breathing one time a minute. If they're just irritable, you as a mom, you as a dad know your kids. If there's something's not right, I can't even console him. I mean, I can't hold him and not make him feel better in any way possible. Usually that's because they have fever. If you give them the appropriate dose of Tylenol, the appropriate dose of ibuprofen, and yes, you can use them both at the same time. You can give both at the exact same time. Then 4 hours later, if they still have it, an elevated temperature, you can give Tylenol. 6 hours after the initial dose, you can give more ibuprofen. That's how they become staggered. But ibuprofen's an every 6 hour med, and Tylenol's an every 4 hour med. But fever with a rash. I almost didn't put that in there. But viral illnesses will give you a little bit of a rash often. It's kind of just like a light pink, minimally raised rash. The rash we're looking at are they're called petechiae. They're small, kind of thing, but I wish I put a slide up to show you the danger rash. They're like dark purple spots. So if you have a kid who has fever with dark purple, small, and we're talking just a couple of millimeters, dark purple spots, that would be concerning and should seek medical attention. Vaccinate. It is the most important step in protection against the virus. Like I said, though, however, it is not guaranteed. If the flu vaccine, and we'll get upon it right now, is only made up of usually three that protects against three most common strains. If for that year, the CDC, the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, misfired and did not include a strain, and the viruses were smarter than we were, and the flu that year is with a strain that the vaccine is not being given for, it's not going to work. So it's not 100% guaranteed. The way vaccines work is they are an inactive form of the flu virus. However, they still have the proteins on the surface, the H and the N, for the body, the immune system to mount antibodies for. So that's where immune system works. These antibodies are soldiers. They go out and they kill. So if you have an inactive form of the virus, it's not going to cause the illness. Okay, you get a lot of people saying, I got the flu really bad this year because I got the flu vaccine. It was all due to the flu vaccine. I disagree. The inactive form is not. You probably got the flu because you did not have a good response, your body didn't mount a good antibody response to it, or you got sick by a strain that the vaccination did not cover. But the vaccination stimulate the immune system to make antibodies, the soldiers, against the antigen, which is the virus. Very important here, we're hitting on it now. Vaccination is also very important for healthcare workers and those who live or care for high-risk people. And we can, like you said, we can also add the working with children as well. Children have the same, there are viruses that children get, but they cause the common cold that usually adults don't get. Because our bodies have been exposed to those antigens, those viruses, so many times that we, as adults, constantly have these antibodies in our system. So there are, like I said, there are viruses that kids get and they get sick from it, but we don't because we are already immune to them. But if you work with kids, and particularly if you're caring for your 89-year-old grandmother who has diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, COPD, you yourself need to get vaccinated, because I'm sure the last thing you guys want to do would be bring the flu virus home to him or her. And it says very important for healthcare workers, obviously, for us to get our vaccines, because we don't want to spread it from ourselves. We don't want to be a vector carrying it from one patient. When I go in the room and then I go and see you in the other room, I dang well better wash my hands, but still that's even not 100% guaranteed. So yes, I did get my flu vaccine in October. Traditional flu vaccines are made to protect against three different flu viruses. Really, to talk about influenza, be influenza A, which are the H and the N's, and then you have influenza B, which is another flu virus, but it's made up totally different as far as its internal structure. Usually what gets us are the influenza A viruses. So usually they cover against, the vaccine covers against three viruses, we call it trivalent. The most common ones that infect us throughout time have been the H1N1 and the H3N2. So usually the flu viruses we get are trivalent. They cover against two of the influenza A and one of the influenza B. As I stated before, the vaccine is the inactive form of the virus, which stimulates the body's production, antibody production. Get vaccinated ASAP. It takes about 2 weeks once you get the vaccine for the body to fully mount its response and to develop those soldiers, those antibodies, to protect against the virus. So if you got vaccinated yesterday, you're still definitely able to pass on the virus to others. But like I said, about 2 weeks. Treatment, you treat the symptoms. Tylenol and ibuprofen for fever and body aches. No antibiotics. It's a virus, not a bacteria. It's not strep. It's not staph. It's a virus. Do not need. Avoid alcohol and smoking. Definitely both. But smoking is also going to weaken. What smoking does is it impedes our ability to clear secretions. And the secretions just sit down there. So smoking, it literally, the smoke and the heat, honest to goodness, burn off what's called the cilia. When we breathe in air, and it goes down into our trachea and out and into our bronchi, there's small little hair-like projections that help filter out the impurities, dust, pollen, whatever it is. Those cilia are totally destroyed smokers. It's just one flat tube. It's like the best water slide in the world. There is nothing there. You know, it's just going down there. So smoking, I probably should have included that on people at risk, but it's probably being a little bit redundant. Because if you've smoked that much to have that happen, you probably have a degree of COPD. So I would include a chronic smoker and a chronic alcoholic on the high-risk patient list. This is topping for hot debate. Antiviral medications, the most common one by far and away is Tamiflu.
Oh.
Here's what I found out. Tamiflu had a huge campaign, and this was just crazy. You guys can all look it up, Google it. It's just crazy. The Center for Disease Control and Prevention. I never knew this until about a year ago. Do you know that they take funding, private funding from pharmaceutical companies? They accept that. They accept that. And I think that is a conflict. I think it is a horrendous conflict. It is a horrendous conflict. So they take private donations from pharmaceutical companies. It's very well known. You can Google it and whatnot. The year in which about 3 years ago, where Tamiflu was just, everybody was coming in for Tamiflu. And it's, holy crud. It's, the research is there. It shows that there can be a benefit of taking Tamiflu if you take it within 48 hours of developing symptoms of the flu. But what it does is the research has shown that it may decrease the amount of time you have the flu by about 12 hours.
That's all it does?
Yeah. It doesn't cure it. It might, and I keep on using might. It's all there, all over. That's why, and when the CDC came in and they were, and they have really backed off that because they have been called on this. That year, I don't know the exact amount. They got a large amount of funding from the pharmaceutical company that produced Tamiflu. So I thought that was horrendous. But that is where that comes from. Now, if you came in to me and you said, I've been sick for a day for 24 hours, and I think you really have the flu, and particularly if you work with kids or you're taking care of an elderly, debilitated one at home, would I give you Tamiflu if you really wanted it? Yeah, I'm not gonna fight you and argue with you. I'm gonna inform you that, okay, you'll probably have it for maybe 12 hours less than you would normally have it or whatnot, but it's not the end all be all that it's, that a lot of people have tried to portray. The emergency room is a very unique place. I love it to death. It always keeps you on your feet. And people come in for some of the most ridiculous things in the world. And a lot of times people don't feel as if they're getting their money's worth, their time's worth, unless they leave the emergency room with something. So here's a prescription for Tylenol. Here's a prescription for ibuprofen. I try, and I spend a lot of time when we work in our front of the emergency room is where we see a lot of the lower acuity stuff. So I spend a lot of times with moms explaining why I'm not giving little Johnny an antibiotic for their runny nose. But usually that goes okay. Usually I'll take time to explain why it may not be given the antiviral medication or the antibiotics, as long as you take your time to explain it to a patient. If the person is rational, and not all the time is the person rational, but if they're rational, they tend to understand. So chronically sick people, and what I mean from going way back to that slide, right there, that group of people can get secondarily infected. And what I mean by that is, again, your immune system is weakened. It's now further weakened by the flu. Particularly if you're a smoker, you have no way of clearing those secretions. That it's taking bacteria take advantage of what is happening to you right now. And bacteria are saying, hey, let's get him or her while he or she is down. Let's add to this. We've got a good host. Let's jump on this. So you can get a thing called a secondary infection, an opportunistic infection, such as pneumonia. And if it's hard to prove it's bacterial, like I say, you can culture sputum and see what grows, but the color of the sputum doesn't mean anything. But if a person who has flu-like symptoms, who has symptoms also of a pneumonia, who also is high risk, then I'd probably be treating that patient with antibiotics, okay? So I don't wanna sound hypocritical here. You do not treat flu with antibiotics, but they can get secondarily infected with a bacteria, and at that time you would treat with antibiotics. Treatment also is just doggone stay home. I mean, anybody who has a job and is willing to work, I applaud you. You're a productive member of society. I will be glad to give you a note to stay home. And it's so hard to say for how long. Like I said, you're infective from one day before getting the symptoms to about 1 week after. As far as how long you'll have the symptoms and feel like crud is probably a week. If you really were working with high risk with children or working with the developmentally disabled, I'd probably keep you off for the entire week. And as stated there, most people recover fully in 1 to 2 weeks. Prevention, wash your hands and a lot. Wash. We have the Purell does an okay job, but it's really not a substitution for washing hands with soap, not just with water with soap. Purell does an okay job. We've got some alcohol-based sanitizers in the emergency room that we use. That works good. I think they all have over 99% of decrease in the infectivity. Face masks, it's got to be the right face mask because the flu particle is small. Just a normal one. It helps somewhat. Obviously, if you're sneezing, if you're coughing, the particles aren't going out as far as if you have any mask on, but they're not 100%. Clean. And what am I meaning by clean? Your home. The Clorox sanitizer rubs for kitchen counters. If somebody is sick at home and they drink out of glass, obviously don't make sure that glass doesn't sit around. Make sure it's washed quickly. But just wiping everything down. At Costco, you see a lot of times they have the sanitizer things for the handrails for the carts and whatnot. Those, I'm being hypocritical because I don't use them, but you probably should use them. Just being honest, I don't, and I should. Avoid contact with sick people. Yeah, that's a good advice, right? If you know somebody's sick, you know, don't go out of your way to get around them. Cover your mouth. Sounds like common sense, but to some people it's not. If I had a dime for every time, you know, you get down there, you're listening to the person's lungs, and you're listening to the heart, and you listen to the lungs, you say, I tell them, take a deep breath, and the person goes right in my face. It's like, sometimes things have to be explained.
If the vaccine is not guaranteed, can I take another vaccine, for example, October, and take one December, and take another one?
That's an excellent question. It's the same vaccine. They only come out, very good question, but they, all the vaccine for the given year is all the same. Other than for the strains, the nasal vaccine that they spray up the nose, from 5 years old to I think it's 65, 5 to 65, is actually a different, it's the same strains, but it's actually an active influenza form of the virus. So like I said, the shot is an inactive form of the virus. That's actually real flu they're spraying into your nose. Ooh. Honest to goodness. It's just at a concentration where it usually won't give you symptoms. So in other words, they would never do that to a person at high risk. You should never be getting the nasal vaccines if you're in the high risk category. But that vaccine is the same strains as the shot vaccine. Summary point. So, if you are, I just love this right here.
It was brave of you to come in to work with the flu and give us all the flu. That's what I say, just stay home. Try not to infect your coworkers. If you're young and healthy, stay home, treat your symptoms, avoid contact with others. Hydration, the reason why everybody says stay hydrated, hydrate, 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 you'll feel better. It does not take much at all to get dehydrated, absolutely. And if you're dehydrated, your electrolytes and your blood get off kilter and it makes you feel like crud. So hydration, I'm fine with water. No soda, no beer, milk's probably not the best thing. Gatorade, Powerade, those are fine. I'm all good with that. If you like Enfalite or Pedialyte, I'm fine with that too. I have no problem with that. And just write it out. You will get better. Like I said, this is the caveat. If you're young and healthy, if you're 30 years old, you don't have a single medical problem, you're fine. Particularly if you're a male, you're a big baby, you're fine. And it is. Women tend to handle pain and discomfort better than we men do. It pains me to say that. It really does. It really does. But I think it's because you guys have to get childbirth. I think you guys are more inclined. You should say that. Guys think their world is ending. And I can always tell how good a man was to a woman during her pregnancy and when she was in labor. Because when he comes in with a kidney stone, and she's either sympathetic if he was good, or she's laughing her rear end off at him if he was mean and bad. So it's kind of like payback. But women tend to handle pain and discomfort better than men. When I preach to my kids, diet, sleep, and exercise. Diet, sleep, and exercise. Have a reasonable diet, you need to get enough sleep, and you need to exercise. Never stop moving. That is in a lot of disease entities. Orthopedic surgery, them putting in hips. It used to be, oh, get a lot of bed rest, get a lot of bed rest, get a lot of bed rest. Bull. Almost every disease entity, no, you don't need bed rest. Absolutely not. You need to get up, you need to keep moving. When you stop moving, you die. You do. Physically, mentally. When you stop moving, you die. So it's very important. If people, they're getting up the next day with hip surgeries, they used to say doing lumbar punctures, spinal taps in the emergency room. They used to say, oh, you have to lay flat for an hour afterwards. Bull. Absolutely not. And totally. So when you stop moving, you die. Yes, ma'am? There's nothing specifically has ever been shown once you have the flu to make you feel better other than staying hydrated and keeping your fever down. If you keep your fever down, you'll be fine. There's nothing that's ever been shown specifically one type of food once you're sick to help you get better. Now, prevention. Chicken's healthy, protein, non-fatty, very healthy. The broth of a soup. Very healthy, so I'm all for chicken soup as far as for prevention. I'm talking, anything, and I tell patients, particularly people who have gallbladder disease, avoid hot, spicy, greasy, fatty foods. And that's almost any fast food. So if you're eating any fast food, you're probably not eating well. If you're cooking it at home yourself, as long as you're not deep frying it, I'm sure it's more healthy than any fast food would be. Anything God created is good for you. That's what I believe. Vegetables, fruits. I mean, you can't go wrong with that. I'm not the biggest vegetable eater in all my life, and I'm praying that my grandfather only ate corn, and that's corn and carrots, I think it was. That's it. He hated every other vegetable. He lived to 96 years old and wasn't on a single medication when he died. He called.
Whoa.
I know. So a lot says about genes. He called doctors a bunch of pill pushers. So I'm hoping my lack of vegetables is taken up by my genes. But
vegetables are fantastic for you. Anything with antioxidants in it, those are the big things right now, are good. So that's my feel. If it's made at home, just don't deep fry it. It's better than any fast food. Any fast food is evil. El Pollo Loco chicken is probably okay, just don't eat the skin. Yes, ma'am.
So, I have two questions. One is, okay, so you mentioned coronary artery disease and cancer. Okay, that's going to be the first question about anything. The second one's going to be about refilling water bottles. It's like, you can't really make them with bleach.
Refilling what?
Water bottles, you know, people carry, and like, okay, so the first one is the cancer and the coronary artery disease. Because is it the disease, or is it if you're taking medicines that mess up your immune system?
It's probably both. I would think first and foremost, your body is, even though you have coronary artery disease, let's say you had an angiogram and you had a stent put in your heart. Again, your body knows it shouldn't be there. It knows it's been messed with. The immune system, doggone knows. So then when you couple that with taking a medication to help you not clog up the stent, Plavix or whatnot, they usually put you on cholesterol medication, what's called a statin as well. Medications, you've got to be very, very careful with. I think medications used in the right setting are fantastic. Those two in the history, in the setting of coronary artery disease is great. But it is better to be on the least amount of medications as possible. If that's the only medical problem you have, you should be on Plavix, aspirin, and probably a statin medication. Everybody doesn't need to be throwing other stuff at you. But it's more so the disease process in and of itself, because your body is already busy fighting off what is infecting it. Because that's what a disease is. If you've got clogged arteries, it kind of is almost like an infection. It's an inflammatory response syndrome and whatnot. So infection and disease kind of almost go hand in hand. In fact, there was a big, although it was disproven, there was a big study done several years ago on whether or not coronary artery disease was caused by a viral infection. Honestly, God, there was no, it never, it turned out to be nothing, but yes. Oh, no, I'm sorry, second part. I would never refill and use a water bottle, I wouldn't. It's just colonization of bacteria after the water's gone. And not, I'm sorry, not just bacteria, viruses as well. I would never do it.
So we should just go ahead and spend the money and get a bunch of water bottles and throw them out.
Yeah, or if you have,
or recycle them.
If a good refrigerator, if you have water through and a good filter, that's also shown to be.
But the actual water bottle that you're using, I mean, you're washing it, but you don't get everything out of it.
You just don't. Yeah. You just don't. It's amazing.
You don't get dishes either, probably.
Yeah. So no, I would not reuse water bottles.
People said we use knee consecutive within 3 minutes. Yeah, in row, 3 times in a row, use 1 teaspoon of salt with hot water and then gargle with, did it help with the cold or the flu?
And this is what I always say, it doesn't matter what I think or what research says, it matters whether or not it makes you feel better. If that right there is not hurting you, if you think it makes you feel better and it does make you feel better and it's not hurting you, which that would not be hurting you, by all means, do it. Shoot, don't let anybody tell you, oh, that's an old wives' tale, it doesn't work. I mean, whether it works or not, you believe that it works and it makes you feel better, that's all that outcome matters, as long as it's not hurting you. Another thing, that's the power of the mind. The power of the mind can definitely heal.
Then I've got a lot of fresh lemonade.
Mm-hmm.
Help?
I've heard people swear by that. Anything citrus. Yeah, citrus. Then there's a belief that stimulates, again, strengthens the immune system. That's where vitamin C. Vitamin C doesn't do anything when you actually have the cold, but it helps you prevent getting the cold, and that's through strengthening of the immune system.
And also, when I have a cold or a flu, I think I'm a little bit weak. I always feel so chilled.
Yes.
And then my mom said, use a piece of ginger, smash it, and cook barbecue water. It really does.
Does it work?
Warm, yeah, keep you warm.
You hear about ginger all the time. You hear about ginger all the time. Particularly in the Asian population, it's got a strong belief. So I'm a strong believer in Eastern medicine, it's just not Western medicine as well. Eastern medicine does have, people swear. When my wife was pregnant with our first child, there wasn't a medicine on the face of God's green earth that would keep her from vomiting. She went to an acupuncturist, had acupuncture done one time, then vomited the rest of the pregnancy. Absolutely amazing. So you're never going to tell her that acupuncture doesn't work, because it worked for her. So, and I believe. Yes?
How do you know if you're dehydrated? Are there symptoms when you're dehydrated?
Rapid heart rate, rapid breathing, weakness, fatigue, muscle cramping, severe cases, dizziness. The first sign would be that your heart is beating faster and stronger than normal. You know, and what I mean, fast, if it's below 100, you're probably okay. If it's starting to get above 100, yeah, that would be the first sign. But then just the feeling of being weak and run down, and feeling winded, just doing your normal activities of daily living. And it doesn't take long, even for healthy people. Yes, sir?
When I was young, my mother used to give me a lot of chicken soup.
Yeah.
Does it help?
And I think that was that was the same question.
Yeah.
There are millions of people who swear by it, and millions of mothers, and I would never piss off the mothers. I think if they say it works, it works. I don't think it's hard to like really prove something like that. And believe me, I think studies have been done. They have probably taken somebody who's had the flu and fed them chicken soup for a week, and somebody who's had the flu and fed them no chicken soup, and it's probably shown that the person who got chicken soup got better faster. I bet you it does. But I don't think it's ever been proven that way. Yes, ma'am.
When my husband got his flu shot, he was asked whether he would like to take the regular one or the double the strength.
And what was it? Take a lever?
No. Oh. Whether he would like to have a shot that's typical,
okay.
Typical vaccine shot, and a stronger one that's two times the strength. Is that
Who asked it, the doctor? I'm wondering if they were talking about the live vaccine versus the inactive vaccine. I think that's probably what they were talking about. Do you have any health problems, sir?
Yes.
Yeah, so
I took the inactive one.
I don't know what they're talking then about the souped up version, the double strength one, the double shot. No, I don't know. Did you get just the regular one? Yeah, I think that's probably the best.
That's why I'm scared to take the shot. I haven't done one.
I would. I think it'll be okay. And like I said, there's still a lot of time because January is the peak season. January is when the flu really hits. So you still got. Remember what I said. It takes about 2 weeks. Yes, sir. Excellent question. Probably about 6 months. Yeah, probably about 6 months. So it gets you all the way through
always.
The flu season. Flu season normally ends about March. So it usually has a 3 month livelihood. So that's why if you get it in October, it's taking you all the way through. And that is a great question there. And I get that question all the time. And it is tough. If you've never had the flu and you've never been vaccinated, your body's doing something right. So the question is, would you get the vaccine? If I never had the flu and things were great the way things are, I wouldn't mess with it. I know it's a little bit contradictory to what I'm saying.
Too, but
no.
Yeah, so you have to be careful. I mean, I think getting the vaccine, I really don't think it's going to hurt you, but who's already with success so far? And you've had the chronic problems for a while. Okay. And it's obviously not weakening you to the point where you needed the flu vaccine before. So, I mean, that's great.
We're
part
of the team. We're kids. And I'm
also supposed to get the shot.
And so they're not experiencing
all the stuff. Yeah. Contagious.
Yeah.
100%. You're correct. That is 100% true.
Yeah.
All right. So that would be a reason to get it. Yes.
What about it?
Yes.
We're always around.
For what sound?
Cats, dogs, horses,
pets. Different type of flu.
different kind of flu. The vectors of our flu are basically from birds. Birds carry. You've heard of the bird flu? That's the birds are the ones that are the vectors that carry it on to humans, and then we transfer it from one to another. Cat and dog flu, if they do get the flu, is a totally different strain. They're mammals, but it's still a totally different strain. Different species.
Yeah, cold, you know, I usually get a lot of raw mint, basil, just eat it like this.
If it keeps you healthy, I mean, again, that stuff is absolutely not hurting you. I don't think that's a, again, what I try to live by too, but what I believe, if God made it, probably good for you. You know, so I think that's good, particularly if it keeps you healthy. It keeps you healthy up here, keeps you healthy physically, because there's a strong tie between mental health, how strong you are here, and the body's health.
Yeah.
Very strong.
Question. Years ago, this person told me that don't get the flu shot. Do not get the flu shot because it'll go to the liver and stay there and harm you. Is that true?
Mm-hmm.
Where does it go? You said it goes into the body.
Zero truth. It is metabolized. It gets into the bloodstream.
Okay.
Through our capillaries.
Okay.
So technically it goes all over. It goes to liver, it goes to kidneys, it goes to brain, it goes to heart, but it also goes to bone marrow, okay, where the immune system propagates, okay? So it goes there. It is, as far as metabolized out of the body, you're getting such a small quantity, it's not, like if you take a medication, if you take a high blood pressure medication, most of the high blood pressure medications are metabolized from the kidneys. Okay. Most pain medications are metabolized by the liver. A virus really isn't metabolized. It's really not sorted out. It either propagates in the body or it's destroyed by the body and the immune system. So I don't know where that would have been.
It says don't take it because it'll go to your liver and stay there and harm the liver. It's not doing you any good. It just stayed here.
Yeah, no, exactly. I can guarantee you there's zero truth to that. Zero truth.
If you don't take the flu hit you, you die faster.
Yeah. Before it would take out your liver. Yes.
I have a friend that she took the flu shot, she had a big reaction. She tried taking high blood pressure medicine and she lost a reaction. Pain medicine, the kind you get when you get out of the hospital, big stuff. Mm-hmm. She gets all of the symptoms. What is it with her immune system?
She sounds like she's got a lot of health problems, yes?
No, she doesn't. She has bad news. She's got that. She has blood pressure recently.
So high blood pressure and then even arthritis. Arthritis is an inflammatory state.
But I think for a long time, even before all this, if she took certain things, she would react.
So she had a reaction to the
flu
vaccine?
Shots, yeah.
What was the reaction?
I don't know.
Yeah. Reaction might be more of a what's called a side effect. Whenever you introduce anything into the body, any medication on God's green earth, you look up, and the most common side effects are going to be nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. It can always cause side effects. So maybe she was having side effects. Maybe it was something else. Maybe it was medication that was actually causing her to have a reaction as opposed to the flu vaccine itself. It is common to mount a little bit of an increased temperature. It never should go above 101 degrees after a flu vaccine, because again, fever is the body's way of drowning out whatever's infecting it. So when you get fever, there's something going on that the body doesn't like, and it's trying to drown it out. So that's what fever is. So fever is actually a good thing. The only reason why we treat it is
it's a good thing to get rid of stuff, but that's really a bad
to let things run its course.
Yeah.
The only reason why we treat fever with Tylenol and ibuprofen is because it's so doggone uncomfortable to have it. I mean, when you have fever, you're feeling like crud. And then when you don't have fever, you might not be feeling up to your normal loads, but you're still feeling a lot better than when you had it. So fever is the body's natural response to trying to drown out whatever's infecting it. So you just introduced, even though I said it's an inactive form, and it is an active form of the virus, you're introducing something to the body that the body recognizes. And it is stimulating the immune system to do something, so the body knows it's there. Yes, sir.
Is it safer to take ibuprofen because they
Ibuprofen is actually metabolized by the kidneys. Tylenol is by the liver. Yeah. So if you take them both as prescribed in a typical dosage, and you don't take too much of them, and you're only taking it for a week's period of time, you're fine on either one. Now, if you already have liver problems, it'd probably be a good idea to stay away from the Tylenol, because that's used by the liver, and take the ibuprofen. If you have kidney problems, it's probably better to stay away from the ibuprofen and take the Tylenol, because it's metabolized by the liver. If you have both kidney and liver problems, ask your doctor. Go from there. See which one's worse.
Still with
it. Ask your doc. Keep him or her informed. Any other questions, guys? Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.